of Western European socialism. Not socialism.
Every word of that
fascism
was just lit to me.
So, every syllable
was just
North, and that's it. I'm sorry, y'all.
I'm from the Midwest, sir.
There's a town in West Virginia called Big Ugly.
Yeah, it's not surprising.
I love these facts so much.
Dude, there were legit 5 jokes running through
my mind. Imagine right now where you come from. Big Ugly. Yeah, that checks out. That ain't surprising at all.
Big Ugly West Virginia.
Just look at your ID. Are you the mayor?
Because, like, even, like, out of context, it's just, like, Big Ugly West Virginia. It's like, hey, our state isn't that bad. It's like, no, I'm just saying a city. It's a place that exists.
Big Ugly, comma, West Virginia.
Oh, I would hate it.
Oh, legitimately.
Imagine you're a basketball star. Hailing from Big Ugly West Virginia.
Nintendo absolutely knows about the internet Triton because like a couple months after the Bowsette thing happened, they changed the crown's description. It was just like, only Toadette can wear this crown. So it's just like, kill that noise. Martin Luther King Jr. earned a C in his public speaking class during his 2 semesters in seminary school.
Who is that teacher?
Who's the dude?
Okay, is it a white teacher? And is that the reason why? Who was the dude that... Because you know you gotta wake up one day
and just
20
go,
years later.
That mom changed everything.
And I gave him a motherfucking C.
He wrote the I Have a Dream speech in school. He's just like, why are you writing about dreams? Dreams are for children.
You'll never make it, Martin. This is trash.
Or does the dude wake up like, yeah, my seat incentivized him to get
fired? Y'all know I was his teacher,
yeah.
And I told him that I was pushing him to do better.
Apply yourself.
Oh my goodness.
You can go one or two ways with that way. Either A, I'm a fraud, or B, I'm inspiring people so hard that I inspired the civil rights movement. Just through my teacher.
It's just some like physicist teacher in like the 30s is like, oh man, look, I'm looking through all these old papers that I got, physics papers. Look at this D minus I gave to this kid named Albert Einstein.
Oh, no, surely that can't be the same one.
Dude, imagine Stephen King in a creative writing class. Oh. C minus, sir. Your adjectives, I don't know what you're doing. Look at that dog with rabies. What's up? In Tupac in math class, the teacher just comes up. Tupac, what I tell you about writing raps in class? You're not gonna make it with this. You need these numbers. Get the bumps in you. And then 4 years later, you gotta dance around to Slip Up. You wanna close banging it.
You know I taught Sue Tupac.
Oh dude, I would never sleep.
I'd be shaking.
The PS5 in a year has outsold the Wii U's lifetime sales.
Y'all leave the Wii U alone. Try his best.
Hey, consumers did.
Accurate.
That's not.
Yes, it is.
Early
yes,
adopter.
That's exactly what we're going for.
Oh, dude, I will never forget that woman with all them Wii U's in the back of her car thinking she was going to flip them boys.
Oh, someone tried to do that near you guys?
No, it was it's a viral picture.
Oh, okay. I don't remember that.
You never seen it?
No.
Oh, dude, I'll look it up.
I think I've seen this.
It's unfortunate. Let's see what else we got. Nigga. Well, actually.
Yep. Oh. All I had to look up was Wii U woman.
Wii U woman. Oh, this is gonna be
good. Some. Get some, y'all.
See, Wii U woman.
No, I already got it in for you.
Okay.
Where's it going?
He posted it in chat.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no.
Scalper beautifully boned.
Oh, those are like even. Ooh. Ooh. There's probably like two per box in the boxes behind her, too. Yikes.
That boy's in a backseat and everything. Yeah, you can see him on the console. Dude, this is at least 10? She's like, this is my retirement. Yeah, she thought she was going to flip these for double, because remember, the Wii was having supply issues, so this is the next console of the Wii, so why wouldn't I do it?
She didn't find it odd that she can buy in 15 of them?
Day one. In the store.
Yeah, I was, because of like what the day I went through trying to get a Wii when it first came out, where I lucked the fuck out, someone, by someone's generosity, which, where's that in this world? Where I was just so concerned about getting a Wii U day one, where I just walked into GameStop, I'm like, do you guys go Wii U's? Oh, yeah. Oh. Okay.
And no weights there, bruh.
Yep.
Remember at my GameStop, they had a tower of them, dude. Just to be able to grab and go.
Yeah, why?
You ain't even gotta pay, pimpin'. Just go ahead and take it.
Because they thought it was gonna be another Wii situation where they were just gonna fly off the shelf. They probably overstocked and everything.
Oh yeah, GameStop for real had that problem.
Please take these. We need to put the... We have another display that we need to put here.
$100 off, please, anybody. Mm-hmm.
Can I get this keychain? Absolutely. And here's your complimentary Wii U.
I'm good.
Wii U featuring the upcoming great title, Zombie U. Remember that one? That was one of their big
titles. They ported it to PlayStation.
Yeah, PlayStation 4. It was on PlayStation Plus.
I played it at a con. It was a fun game.
It was decent. I got it because it was a launch game.
I will just never forget that trailer. Everybody's just like, N? What?
Nobody cares. I remember Mike hyping that bush up. Oh, I remember. It's so innovative where you're just like, a zombie's coming and you gotta look down and go, shit, and try to get your thing, as opposed to pause. Find item. Oh, I remember you hyping that bullshit up.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I'm having flashbacks to that now, too.
Oh, man.
It's a lot better in the Zelda games that came out for Wii U. Having the menu management there.
I minored in history with a focus on the development of Western European socialism. Not socialism.
Every word of that.
Fascism.
Was just lit to me. So, every syllable was just like,
North and that's it. I'm sorry, y'all.
I'm from the Midwest, sir.
There's a town in West Virginia called Big Ugly.
Yeah, it's not surprising.
I love these facts so much.
Dude, there were legit 5 jokes running through my mind.
Imagine right now where you come from. Big Ugly. Yeah, that checks out. That ain't surprising at all.
Big Ugly West Virginia.
Just look at your ID. Are you the mayor?
Because out of context, it's just like Big Ugly West Virginia. It's like, hey. Our state isn't that bad. It's like, no, I'm just saying a city. It's a place that exists.
Big Ugly, comma, West Virginia. Oh, I would hate it.
Oh, legitimately.
Imagine you're a basketball star hailing from Big Ugly, West Virginia.
Nintendo absolutely knows about the internet Triton because like a couple months after the Bowsette thing happened, they changed the crown's description. It was just like, only Toadette can wear this crown. So it's just like, kill that noise. Martin Luther.
everyone, and welcome back to the Podcast of Stuff, episode 297. Three away.
The big three away!
Game. Yep.
Like we're going to do anything with it.
Yeah, I know.
We should.
I need to build
we
kind of
should.
I need to build this fake gravitas.
We should do something. We never do anything.
Dude, legitimately, over on a list exists, it's like, oh, it's our 100th episode. Okay.
But yet that setup for April Fool's was essentially like a celebration with how much work you guys put into it.
I mean, it was no kind of celebration. That was for us.
Exactly. Self-celebration.
April Fool's is literally the only time we can cut loose and do some goofy stuff.
The only thing that I could even think of is like face cam. Like, what else can we do on the podcast?
Hell yeah, from now on, face cam or something.
Yeah.
We could. Technically now, we definitely could.
We could.
Yeah.
That is an option. Or we could do an AMV stream and get banned.
Man.
Legitimately banned.
Gone are the times of Justin TV, Ralph. We don't have gone.
We gotta bring it back. We gotta fight the power. Maybe Elon Musk will buy Twitch and we'll be okay.
I didn't even realize too, like for whatever reason, I thought that if you exported Twitch VODs, mm-hmm. that anything that was muted was just, you know, it was only for the Twitch VOD. Once it got to YouTube, it'd be unmuted. Nope.
No, definitely not.
One of the songs from Smash Bros. And one of the terms that I had, I was just like, oh. Oh, there's just no audio during this match. Okay. But yeah, light news week this week. So obviously we'll just be kind of bullshitting and for a few other things. So speaking of that 100th episode, how did that go?
It was terrible.
Oh.
It was legitimately a horrible episode.
You're asking them how one of their things went. It's never going to say good.
Well, we did, so for our 100th episode, instead of recording it, we decided to live stream. And the live stream, for anybody that doesn't know, our fans have introduced us into What If content, which is essentially stuff like, what if Broly came to Earth with Goku, and then somebody creates a story and just reads it out for legitimately 8 hours of storytelling.
Video fan fiction.
Yes, video fan fiction. And, We just went through 3 hours of What If content, and a couple of them were just like, meh. And oh, there was one dude, Goku T23, that was so horrible. It almost shut the stream down for 20 to 30 minutes. Because all he did was, he had a tournament of Gokus, and what he did was take all his What If Gokus and put them into a tournament with each other. So it was just him naming off the Gokus he's done. So it was like Omni Instinct Goku, and it would be Goku with like a galaxy body and orange hair.
So is this like the like Spider-Verse comics where like the vampire yes. people were killing them off and like... One of the Peters had become like semi-omnipotent.
Yes, stuff like that.
They were all terrible. Recolors and just redos of just this worst fanfic garbage that you can ever possibly think of.
The names weren't even good. It was like Ultra Saiyan Goku.
Primal Instinct. Natural Instinct.
Demonic the Dragon Instinct had horns floating on its head. Like, it wasn't just the dude just going, oh, these are the characters. No, he reskinned, he added things to Goku. It was horrible.
I mean, if he's dragon skin Goku, then he needs to have horns. I don't see the problem.
Clearly.
Here
and the 4-star Dragon Ball right in the middle of his forehead.
Oh, of course. Did what you not see the Shadow Dragon arc?
Dude. DA was so mad during the segment. Every Goku, he was ripping off his headphones and shaking with rage. He was frustrated beyond all belief. I was laughing. It was hilarious to me. The incompetence. They weren't even dragon horns. They were basic demon horns.
Mm. So not like to that level. But like in sort of in the vein of What If, so, you know, obviously, I pay attention to a lot of Smash stuff, what yada yada. That's like the one subreddit that I go to is the Smash Bros subreddit. Mm-hmm. And so, and I see a video that has Ridley in the image. I'm like, okay, what's this? And it was someone's reimagining of Ridley in Smash Bros in the moveset. And, like, I consider myself a bit of a fanboy in terms of, like, Metroid and what have you. This guy went hard in terms of just, like, trying to incorporate every single teeny little bit of canon, game or otherwise. Sometimes not even anything about Ridley. I forget what move he was, like, describing, but he was just like, you know, I really like this move from one of the monsters in Monster Hunter, so this will be Ridley's down. I'm like, no. Buddy. Buddy, please stop.
Now, it's so hard with the overt fanboys and fangirls, where it's just like, I just want the characters in the world I like to have all the most awesomest thing. Mm-hmm. Instead of like trying to concoct a coherent story based on the information you already know.
Yes.
It's crazy. And oh, dude, Dragon Ball fans are the absolute worst. They just want everything for Goku and his friends. They want everything for
Gohan.
The
strongest, the biggest, the coolest. And that's always what it just goes back to.
Gavin was like, why? This is all you need to know. Why are what ifs never, oh, they came to Earth later, so everybody's weaker? It's always making everybody or somebody stronger than ever imagined. It's all about being stronger. Deku in Minecraft was crazy. The dude was just voice acting the story, and he was not trying.
Just the worst acting. It's just all of the confusion is, what's going on? Where am I? Who are you? Just what? That over and over.
That stuttering.
Out of anything that you guys have seen in terms of this, because I just had a thought, especially with Dragon Ball, in terms of what is the best what-if story, if you can even say there is one, that you have seen?
I used to read My Little Pony fan fiction. Does that count?
Sure.
You know what? There was a, I've told the story a bunch of times, but before the 7th Harry Potter book came out, it was said that it was leaked, and there was a fanfic that went around. I forgot what it was called, but it basically followed all the conventions of Harry Potter storytelling to the point where people had gotten 60 to 70% of the story, just like, oh, this is pretty good, until they realized that this wasn't actually the book. And a lot of people just finished it, because I was one of those people that just was like, I'm just going to finish it because it's a pretty good story. That's probably the best fanfic. The worst is also a Harry Potter fanfic. but yeah, that was probably the absolute best one, to where it was almost indistinguishable from what you thought the 7th book would be.
Mm-hmm. The top one in my head is Dragon Ball Multiverse.
Yeah.
It actually goes into like those negative scenarios that you were talking about. It's like, what if Goku never hit his head and he just violently murdered everyone?
I read one Ruby fanfic where John. I always forget that. I haven't watched Ruby in forever. Got Ruby pregnant because they got wasted from a huge party.
That's awesome.
Horrible.
Lemons.
Ooh.
Is that still a thing?
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
Probably. I'm assuming.
Oh, DA, how was Ruby?
Oh, dude.
I was going to try and watch it again, but I just that's gonna
worthless.
Happen in the next week or so.
Oh dude.
Worthless.
Oh dude.
Worse than Genlock.
Oh, the Switch. It is just no, nah.
Okay.
So DA, you didn't appreciate the depression to depressionly cured turnaround in two episodes?
The worst season.
You didn't enjoy? Woo! But have you tried not being depressed, being successful?
Hey, but no. You know what? I did just try to kill myself.
Uh-huh.
I choose to be alive now. Uh-huh. That's how it works. Again, I said this when we were doing our watch together. This is the second mother Rooster Teeth project that is just like, nah, suicide is the way. It works out. And I'm like,
Now here's the thing. Here's my question for you. You exist on Twitter. Did you see all of the writing team gush about how proud they were of this season?
They had
proud.
Harry's post.
What do you expect? What do you expect them to do? Just be like, yo,
no,
listen,
we
no. This one, I don't you, this, know, this man. Is the season you can probably just kind of skip. Now, we the cliff notes on this one because it ain't the one.
No, what got me is that they took this season, and Carrie pointed out that he felt that it was important to tell this story the way they did this season to tackle self-doubt.
Yes, that's the biggest thing. I can understand them being like, hey, this is all big old dumb fun action show and we're doing stuff. Hey, they're flying around in rose petals and big scythes and stuff. No, but this is the character season where we sit down and we deconstruct this and we're actually doing writing and character stuff and just really deep introspective stuff.
Yes.
And this is the important season. So you guys really got, I can understand them saying that. But this is, there's a big difference between doing it and doing it well. Yes, they did it. They're just like, hey, we did it.
Same thing.
We did it. It's not the fact that they're doing it well. It's just like, hey, it is.
Yeah, that's very much what you see with a lot of anime fans, where it's just like, this should be praised because it's not following the tropes. Okay, but is the story good? Are what they're doing good? Or is it just that they did a thing that other things don't do? And because of that, please clap.
And it is just...
It's like they tackled attempted suicide. All of this, self-realization and, you know, opening up to who you truly are this season. But let me ask you real quick, DA. Let me ask you real quick with a yes or no. It's all I really want to need.
You know you're not gonna. You know you're not. Whatever you. Whatever the question is. No, that's not gonna be just that. We can commute us, and I'd still find a way to get out. Whatever.
No, I know. Oh no, that was pure hyperbole. Yes or no? Did any of it feel earned?
Not a second.
There we go.
Not a thing.
He didn't say no.
Given the choice, would you rather watch Genlock season 3 or the next season of Ruby?
They did Neo so dirty, and that's why DA is mad. That's why he's mad.
Would you rather watch?
I'm gonna address the Neo thing in a second.
Okay.
season 10 or season 3?
Yes.
There is more that I like in Ruby.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I do not think that this season was a flat zero.
Okay.
I think that Genlock season 2 was a flat zero. There's no place that I want to I want to see no more of that world.
Here's the thing. There's nowhere it can go to where it disappoints you. Because it's a lot of times, it's not so much. A thing can be slightly better than another bad thing, but the fall hurts way more than it being slightly better or slightly worse.
Sure. But I'll say this. The Ruby team has shown the ability to do competent writing.
Yes.
Genlock has not. I have more trust in Ruby than I do in Genlock.
I think Genlock has done well in... ideas as well as more so than execution. The idea that they're having this existential crisis, the idea that Kami is yearning for a family and can't find it with the Genlock team. There's a lot of ideas in Genlock that are legitimately fumbled by the writing team.
Mike, do you care about spoilers?
No.
Okay, good.
Good man. Here we go.
The Neo thing would have been so much better because the Ruby just for some reason, did not even attempt to explain the situation a single time. And it would have been perfect at the very end when she came back, because she looked back at Neo. I went, and as, because, you know, I'm a big, dumb, smelly mark for Neo. Mm-hmm. And again, the Neo stuff did not feel earned. But I was just like, it would have been so much improved if Ruby turned around and just went, look, I know what it's like to lose somebody and to not be there to do anything for it. I feel so sorry that that happened to you, but I did not kill him. And then you do some tree memory bullshit, and Neo sees what happens. You see her get angry for a second and then just look down sort of dejected and accept what happened. And then the rest of that plays out. It would have been improved so much with just a conversation. You don't even need the memory part, but just Ruby going, we were in the same boat, but it ain't what it is, Pippin. I got no reason to lie to you. If I murked homie, I'd say it, but I didn't. She doesn't talk like that, obviously.
No, I think that's the exact script. I think that's the exact
script.
They're
getting close to it, probably. They don't care.
But I was just like, that would have been such a good small conversation of just, I lost somebody, you lost somebody. It sucks balls, but we just gotta go past it.
Yes.
But
instead,
I'm glad she didn't talk. I'm gonna put that over there. But it just seemed, it's just, the revenge thing was just not really a thing, because Ruby could have prevented this by just saying, I didn't do this. And she had two chances to do that. Because as it stands, Neo don't know what happened. Ruby does know what happened. So for some reason, she just went, and she killed him. But I guess I just got to get over that. Yeah, I killed her and she killed him. I guess we squaresies. I wanted so much more. The cloning thing was such a big mistake, because it just unlocks so much that now she just has basically unlimited clones, and she can make a big old building, and she could sustain that big old building with multiple clones. And I go, she's too strong for this. And she can make these people have at least similar enough personalities to the person that she's cloning. You go, okay, so at any point, you could turn a corner and anybody can just be Neo, because the clones are just talking now as well. So every time I see somebody, I'm just like, oh, Weiss is acting weird. That's just Neo. Nope, y'all couldn't even do that. The intro was a lie. We counted. There were 9 silhouettes behind her. She transformed into 7 people in that room. Why were there 9 silhouettes?
Why are y'all so petty to counting?
You know, that's a good question, honestly. I think I was just so salty. But I was just, no, I think it was just going back to the intro and just going, okay, we've seen everything that they're foreshadowing in the intro, so there's now no more things that we can point to and go, hey, look at that. I don't, why? And it's hurt by the fact that she doesn't talk, that we don't understand her mindset of, why does she think that she needs to be reborn and ascended? What does she think is wrong with herself such that she's just like, I need to change?
Yeah, that's not enough. You can't convey that into facial expressions.
Yes, you absolutely cannot. You had Torchwick, who was sort of like her conscience, but he did not properly explain what it was. So even if she does come back bigger and better and newer and all that stuff, she's already been shown not to be able to go through the door because she doesn't have an attachment. What would her being essentially a new person allow her? Why would that allow her to have an attachment now in the other world, unless she became somebody who's already existed, which is a whole nother can of worms, which you can just do. But she's just, there's no reason why we should ever see her again. So now we just have to be like, okay, she's just there forever. Unless we go back to this world, which we just can, because we don't know how Alex and the brother went there in the first place. And the blacksmith was just like, yeah, they opened the door and just made it back and forth so that any of their creatures can come back here at any time. It's okay. Great.
I apologize for asking, how was Ruby?
We're not good. Cool. It is the worst season. They sat down and just went, here's the explanations about the gods. The gods came from this place. With the tree made the gods. I was perfectly fine never knowing where the gods came from. They're the gods. They're over there. It's whatever. I'm fine.
They are allowed to be mysterious.
Yes. And they answered the question that was not asked. Okay, fine. Where did the tree come from? Oh, the tree's always been there. It's always just been this mysterious, omnipotent thing. So why did the gods need an explanation, but not the tree? What does this do for the story to have this information that they just came from this place? It's stupid that they thought that we needed an answer to this when there were so many other questions. They did one single sentence. The whole thing was the world is a big old, it's a fairy tale. A boy and a girl, they hopped into this world.
Yeah.
The boy left. The girl was about to leave, and then she got second thoughts because she messed up the world. And then she was about to leave, and then she decided not to, and she got killed. The dude wrote a story about the world from the girl's perspective. So everybody thought that the girl wrote the book, but the dude wrote the book. Mm-hmm. And the whole time, we were just like, okay, because it's a story told from three different people's perspective. There's one character going, this is what happened, and then one character going, this is what happened, and then one character going, well, according to the story, this happened. So we don't know exactly what exactly happened in the story because we don't know what this story is because it was made up for this entire world. Mm-hmm. So it's three people telling the story and going, no, this isn't what happened, this is what happened. And we don't know what happened, so we can't be like, hey, now they're doing this, and this is what's supposed to happen, and it didn't happen, and so we don't have that through line. So the girl gets killed, and you just go, oh, so the boy wrote the book. So why didn't... We've never had an author story, a picture... Nothing, an interview, nothing about this dude who wrote the story. And at the very end, the blacksmith just goes, yeah, he wrote the story how he wanted it to be. And that was one single line about that. I'm like, this is horrible. People were just thinking, okay, there are three mysterious figures in this world that have big roles in the story. You got the Jabberwocky, you got the blacksmith who's just very mysterious and sort of guiding Ruby and all this crap. And you got Little, who's been around Ruby for this entire time. You got Alex, who died, and when you die, you ascend and you become somebody different. So everybody's just like, okay, she's clearly one of these three things. She was none of them.
Zero of the three.
It's cheeks. it's so incompetent to an unbelievable degree. Last thing I'm going to say.
Mm-hmm.
Little dies. Get stepped on. Great. Fantastic. I didn't care about that little piece. Voiced by Lucy Christian. I love Lucy Christian. Get him out of here.
Went to a whole state for her.
Get him out of here. And comes back in the last episode. No memory of the previous life. They're about to go through the big door. Little just comes up going, wait. And then just starts talking to him. I'm like, why did you tell them to wait? You have no attachment to these people. You don't know what they're doing. And there's not like, and it's not like he was just like, hey, you dropped this or anything. Mm-hmm. He just starts talking. There was no reason to start talking to these people when we've seen two ascensions at this point, which was the herbalist who he just rocked up. He just ascended, hopped out of his dumb cocoon and just looked around and just flew away. And then we saw Ruby who kept her memories. So she knew what she had to do when she started to fight. I know I just said that was the last thing.
Uh-huh. That's why everybody laughed. We knew.
I know.
Uh-huh.
You got Jean, you got Blake, you got Weiss, and you got Yang. They are getting beasted on by this cat. This cat looks horrible, but they're getting beasted on by this cat. okay, fine. The cat's a big, strong cat. Hey, we got it. No problems. Ruby comes out and starts finessing this cat by herself. No problem. And you just have to go, okay, I guess Ruby is better than four other people and an animal who can provide support. And then they all just start beating up on them, and then they win. I'm like, it's you've not established this. You've not established, oh, they're low aura. Oh, man, their minds are broken because it's
the morale.
The morale. The cat's getting weaker by the second. Ruby got stronger because she ascended. You've not established anything other than Ruby just beasting on this. And it's unbelievable that that happened. So, but Red Like Roses played, please clap! And they did! Twitter was on fire because of that
my chair.
Because they played Red Like Roses!
My chair.
We're all right. Chrissy just threw my chair.
He just threw the chair.
It's simple-minded people who see a thing that they recognize and go, ooh. And that's all that they were looking for.
It's the biggest monkey brain thing. It's just like this new season of Demon Slayer, the first two or three episodes, people are like, this is so boring, what is it gonna happen? And then something fight-wise happened this episode, they're like, this is awesome! Now it's all they're waiting for. They want the big hype thing and the big hype song to play, and so they can feel the big hype. I saw Ruby, and I saw it had 58K tweets for trending, and I went, I'm not gonna click on a single one of these, because it's not gonna be a bunch of people going, what the f- is Ruby team doing? This is trash. It's gonna be some fight thing. It's gonna be some animation thing. It's gonna be some hype thing.
Now, BG, physically stop me if I go past this point, because I wish to not think about this any longer. In a previous
episode, for the sake of my chairs, I will.
On a previous episode, they established and
here we go.
And gave weight to an emblem that Ruby has, where she just goes, this emblem holds a mother's promise. They've never established this before. They're establishing this now as she's giving it away. That's fine. Whatever.
That's the team. Sugar's team earring thing.
Horrible. Legitimately not writing. But they did. So we're just going to move past it. That was important. She gave it away for the sake of her friends.
Yes.
Whatever. She gets unascended and she just has it again. Whatever. Whatever.
How about Ruby X Justice League? Excited for that?
No. Oh, I saw that Batman clip. Oh, yep. No. Twitter's on fuego for that. They are not enjoying this.
Really?
It feels like a lot of people that aren't into Ruby are going to start learning about Ruby through this. And they're going to start learning the writing of Ruby.
Yes.
And that's going to be a problem. And I feel like this was written by the Ruby people. And they're going to go, oh, this is trash.
I'm actually curious if it was Rooster Teeth who animated it. Yes, it's in the same style, but that does not necessarily mean that they animated it. I'm curious.
Like the Teen Titans meets Teen Titans Go was animated by the Teen Titans Go people, not necessarily the Teen Titans people, even though they had the same type of style when it got to that point. Best case scenario, Ruby was lying. Alex is just dead, but she can make a magic wish to make John young again to an age Alex never saw John as. That's kind of hell. Talk about how the guys don't want resurrection for some reason. We need to save this for
because reasons.
This is going to be a because reason. This is just a preview.
This is DA venting.
The season finale came out, and it is worth talking about.
Horrible.
And that's all.
Within the next week or so, I will be. I'll just binge it. And then we'll probably do a combo 8 and 9 since we are at this point now.
Horrible.
No.
The worst
volume. No, disagree.
The worst volume.
Disagree.
How do we take the first step? The worst line I've ever heard that's been written. The worst.
So your weekly reminder. Put through the podcast. That Black Lives Matter. Stop Asian hate. Get your vaccines and boosters. Wear your masks in crowded indoor places when you are feeling sick. Support Ukraine. Support LGBTQ rights. Support body autonomy. Pay your employees what they are worth and be good to one another.
You know, I just heard, so I've been listening to the Majority Report with Sam Cedar a lot recently. So I was listening to an old clip, and I heard, I mean, one of the stupidest things I've ever heard in terms of pay your employees what they're worth. It was essentially, they were talking about a fast food worker, and they were like, this guy, the company has deemed what he is worth based on how he acts, how he presents himself, how he, his skill, because his low skill 6-year-old can come in and do his job. But if he came in upselling, being very jovial, working hard, pushing himself, suddenly he has more value to the company and they will pay him a raise. And it's such a disconnect for what actually happens, because working hard and having that type of attitude doesn't make you get more money. All it does is give you more responsibilities, because they're going to be like, all right, you're working hard. Can you cover this person not working hard?
Yeah.
It's the goofy, the mindset of these people that are just, these capitalist people, which are just like, you know, the company deem what you're worth. You can prove your worth every day and it doesn't matter. It's an arbitrary reason they give you or deny you raises.
Yeah.
They give you or deny you whatever pay.
You know what would probably make people happy to come into work and, you know, more jovial and harder working? Being paid more.
Absolutely. Imagine if a fast food worker was paid $19 an hour. If they're still acting out, they should just be let go.
It's just rocking. But it was a study that said that scientifically that the best work hours for productivity is 4-10s.
Let's make it happen, guys.
More rest. And,
been studies overseas where companies have legitimately gone to 3 workdays, 4 workdays. It was a trial run, like 6-month trial run. They were just like, this is fantastic. Let's keep it going.
Because there's not too much of a difference between 8 hours and 10 hours, but there's a big difference between that day that you get off or you don't.
And it's also a huge difference in that these companies, a lot of the return to work, to return to office stuff is they want to quote unquote see you working. And even if your work entails 3 hours of work, they want you to work, look like you're working those 8 hours. Because at home, you can do those 3 hours of work in 3 hours and then have 5 hours to do whatever else you're doing. They don't want that. They want you to stretch 3 hours into 8 so they can look you in your eyes for it.
Mm-hmm.
God, I hate.
You don't know how many sidebar distracting conversations that I have when I'm in the office.
And it makes
for sure.
Sense. And
oh, 1,000%.
Programmers, there's a whole thing of getting in the zone, getting out of the zone, it can take you 20 minutes to get back up into where you are, especially mm-hmm. when you're first starting out. You don't want distractions.
For sure. yeah. I definitely am more for the work at home than I am in office. I do think there still should be a balance. I'm just more skewed to the work from home side than anything, just because.
I feel like a 4-1 with a decent amount of meetings is fine.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably the most optimal. Because it still allows for the collaboration when you go in, what people are working on, so you can work through all of those kinks or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, a lot of people are just working autonomously. Like, they have their task, and they're just doing their task. So why do you need to be in the office for 5 days to do your task? That it's just you doing your task anyway. Yes, I saw that chairwoman with the pity city thing. My God, the disconnect. For anybody that doesn't know, the CEO woman was on a Zoom call or whatever, just going over. We missed our sales projection by like 26 million. And somebody had raised the question about their raises or their bonuses. And she was like, well, we missed the sales projection and blah, blah, blah. Somebody once told me when I was starting out that you can visit Pity City, but you can't live in there. So let's stop this Pity City stuff. Let's get out of there and let's get to work and let's get it done. Wow, she had given herself a bonus of like $4 million. Her salary was something like $1.2 million for the year, and her bonus was something like $4.5 million for the year. So she had four times her salary in bonuses. Or it was like two times or something. 200% of her salary was bonus. Just imagine your common worker. They see a check at the end of the year for 200% of their yearly wage in a check for a bonus. That would never happen. People would go crazy.
Yeah.
How do you get a bonus that is 200% of your salary? This country sucks, dude. Mm. This country sucks.
All right. So, have a few little tidbits of news, but most of it is light talking. Mario Movie is now at 800 mil plus globally.
It's going to top out at about 1.1, 1.2 billion.
Yeah, it's crossing the bill threshold for sure.
And that's just, it's not a good movie, but it's nostalgia, and it feels good to see the Mario movie, and that's enough for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. Feel good movie. Good way to describe it. On the Mario news, are you guys familiar with the story of Gary Bowser?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
just poor naming. for the situation, but
yeah, he was born for this.
this guy Gary Bowser was a part of this like hacking group that was selling
executor or executor or something like that.
Yeah. He's like one of three people. Team Executer, executor. and they were a hacking ring, and they sold chips and other technology that allowed users to play and pirate games. Unfortunately, while he had like a smaller role in the operation, he was the one that was caught. the other three managed to flee their home countries and are in hiding, basically.
based on that ruling, I would be too.
Yeah, he pled guilty. So let's see. Bowser was initially charged with 11 felonies, including wire fraud, conspiracy to circumvent technological measures, trafficking and circumvention devices, and conspiracy to commit money laundering. He pled guilty to two of the charges. He was first sentenced to a fine of $4.5 million, and then later $10 million was added to that, as well as 40 months in prison. he has since been released, but now has to still pay that $14.5 million, let's see, there's agreement with Nintendo, or so he says his pay will continue to be docked until the full amount is paid off. There was agreement with Nintendo only allows between 25% and 30% of his pay to be docked at a time. He's never paying it off.
Yeah, no. For the rest of his life, any money he gets from a company, 25% is going to Nintendo.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Just, obviously he was breaking the law, but just really unfortunate naming.
This is a clear, hey, any potential person that's thinking of doing this, mm-hmm. Don't do this.
That's a mm-hmm. big old smelly example.
No, don't mm-hmm. don't do that. You see what we're capable. You see what we will do.
Mm-hmm.
And it just has proven what they are willing to do.
Yep.
They are willing to take
25%. There was never a doubt.
Yeah. It's and you know, it's different from somebody like some regular hacker that's just like, because Team Executor was, they were scummy. They had DRM on their devices. They were basically telling people to pirate games with their devices, that type of thing. They were giving people the links to get ROMs and that type of stuff. It wasn't just a group of people that's just like, oh, we have this device, we're gonna sell it, and that's gonna be the end of it. They were pushing for this stuff. So they were pretty scummy, but this ruling is gross, because it's, I mean, 25% for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
Sorry to cut you off, but and the problem is that you're not going to get as high a paying job, more than likely, because you've gotten this ruling.
Yeah.
So what are you going to cap out at? 50K a year, 60K a year for the rest of your life? And then 25% is going to Nintendo? So you're paying 15, 20K to Nintendo?
And it's just one of those things, like, you've seen Nintendo, you know, for certain things. It's a lot of times it's like C&D, cease and desist. This is like the one time where they're like, we are actually coming after you legally.
Yeah.
Done, we're burying you.
Yeah.
We're burying you for life.
Mm-hmm. And we'll bury anybody else that tries it.
Mm-hmm.
So you gotta wonder if anybody's gonna try it.
Yeah. Sometimes you need you needed an example, and this is, boy, this is a glowing neon sign. The Aurora Borealis of signs.
It's a pulsing one.
Yeah. On the game front, has anyone seen the footage for Unrecorded?
Yes, I have.
Alf, do you know what we're talking about?
Nope.
So there was some footage of a tech demo or like some kind of potential game coming out. The footage starts off.
No, it's a game.
It started out
as a tech demo, and then it got such good reception from people. Mm-hmm. They were like, okay, we're just going to make it a game.
Yeah. So basically it releases a video and it looks like a police raid of an abandoned building, and the footage.
Oh, I know what you're talking about now. Yes.
Real.
Yeah.
You can't really tell that it's fake until the chase starts and you see like a cursor appear on screen.
Yep.
It's gone too far.
It's
bruh.
Uncanny Valley to the max. Uh-huh.
Yes.
We have transcended.
Now the only thing is it's to the nth degree on the realism scale. But what does it mean to play it? Is it going to be any fun?
Exactly.
Because a lot, sometimes realism, like DA with you in hockey, where you had to use the stick to, that's realism. But to you, you don't want that. You want a little bit of goofiness in your game, at least in your hockey game. So with this game, you know, you saw them hiding behind a wall. Is it going to be one of those, you get a one or two shots in like the gut and you're donezo? You get one shot in the head and you're donezo? I don't know how it's going to be to play,
yeah.
But it's going to be a scary future.
Yeah, just like, and some people, you know, are going, like, this kind of circles back to the whole violence in video games thing. And when things get very real, like very, very, very real, it's like, it's a lot harder to combat that thought.
I will say I very much like the them blurring out the suspects and the other people's faces.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoy that, like it's a cop show, and yeah, we don't want to show the people that died here. I would also very much like it if gunshots, when you hit somebody, that part also got blurred out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the I forget, it was like either an article or something that I saw like many, many years ago. And it talked about going for like, the closer you get to realism, like you kind of divert away, like it's can almost be tangential and like opposing of enjoyment. In terms of just like a lot of people are wanting like these better graphics, better things, but just like when you put so much focus into that side, how much gets diverted from gameplay, enjoyment, interaction, etc.
It's like a Red Dead Redemption 2 where you gotta fish and hunt and it's just completely realistic.
You all saw how pissed I was when I was playing that game where I went, there's like an island where this one animal I had to hunt to get like this upgrade was. You could only have two guns at a time. And I paddled all the way over to that island. And I realized I didn't bring the fucking gun. So I had to go all the way back to my dumb horse to get the gun that I needed. I'm like, this shit could have just been a fucking just wheel of weapons that I could have picked.
Yes. Yeah. And that's where the realism is.
Action.
It's just like,
as Mike slowly.
Immersion. Immersion.
For Red Dead Redemption 2. Splash, splash.
Just muttering to himself and shaking in rage.
Just rowing a damn boat over a river, being like, didn't grab my fucking gun. Come here, stupid horse. Get back in the boat.
And for some people, that type of thing is going to be very fun, but for others, they're going to find it incredibly unfun. So you have to find the good balance for that. But this is going so into the realistic realm, it's hard to think of where it's going to go.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there's so many places it could go. There's so many avenues. It's imagination, right? Like that's how we got here, is that it's always going to become this way. It's always going to come this way because imagination is always going to take us. What can we do to make the imaginative realistic? And I mean, like, for instance, here'd be a neat little uptick. Like if this kind of setting done for like an Elder Scrolls, but like, say you could create a D&D campaign that your players could live out just in that same way. And it looks that clear and that realistic. That'd be dope. So it's all about the way it's portrayed and the way it's directed. But I mean, hey, it's going to go that way anyway.
Yeah, I agree the story is good, but there are so many aspects about the gameplay of that game. I could go on a diatribe about Red Dead 2.
And that's the thing. While the tech of Unrecorded looks very good, how much is it going to translate to a fun game? Because even if the story of Red Dead is good, even if the tech of Red Dead is good, how much did it translate to a fun game? Mm-hmm. That's very much the way I feel about The Last of Us, the first Last of Us. Mm-hmm. I've said it before, the story mode of The Last of Us, I don't think it's a fun game, but I think it's an engaging experience.
Mm-hmm.
If you were to make that even more, let's just say way more realistic, I would find it not even an interesting experience or an engaging experience. I'd find it frustrating. So who knows how Unrecorded is going to turn out.
Yeah.
I have seen people use the tech because once the tech of Unrecorded came out, a lot of people started using that body cam type thing. I have seen it for some horror games and those look incredible.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's where that hyper-realism can go. Something like horror, which is already fantastical.
Oh, yeah. I mean, just you've seen what they did with Resi 7 and 8. And then getting even more quote unquote realistic with that.
Yeah. They dialed back a lot of the over the topness, even though Resident Evil 8 was a little over the top.
But yeah, I'm very interested to see where that goes. And just, I mean, just in general too, just again, cause that was like, it was basically all in Unreal, if I'm not mistaken.
Yep. Unreal 5.
So like that engine can do some good shit.
And they're still updating it with new tech, new bots, new AI, Lumen, all that stuff. So we're going to get some very good looking games when they start translating or when they start transferring over to Unreal 5.
Yep.
They just got to work out a lot of the kinks.
I mean, that's any new game engine, but yeah.
Yep. All right, just some other
smaller tidbits. More, if you are a fan of Stardew Valley, more content is actually going to be coming. The developer decided to take a break from Haunted Chocolatier. He's like, I'm going to fix some stuff and here's some more, a bit more story stuff. It's like, oh, cool. Awesome. Gives me a reason to go back. so we got that. If you're a fan of the Spider-Man movies, basically all of them are coming to Disney Plus now. If you still have a Disney Plus subscription.
That's there good. Is. It's good that they're all in one place.
Yeah. And I'm pretty sure it's like Netflix just had a deal with Sony and then it finally expired. So it's just like, here's basically all of them. I think like Amazing Spider-Man 2 is like the only one that's not going to be.
I don't find that to be a problem.
Yeah, me neither. But it wasn't as bad, Peachy. It wasn't as bad.
No, it was.
That's revisionist history you're talking about. Get that out of here.
The most you could say is Andrew Garfield got screwed over by the script.
There you go.
Yeah.
He deserves a real chance, just like Henry Cavill deserved a real chance. Mm-hmm. Beyond that, I got no praise for that movie.
Yep. We got a little teaser trailer for the next Godzilla and Kong movie with Lanky Kong as the enemy. And that was a fun day on Twitter. So many people.
Yeah, you guys have fun.
I have long since muted Godzilla on my Twitter.
Just in general.
Yep. I'm gonna get nothing from hearing somebody talk about Godzilla, so no.
Why would I hear about Godzilla?
Did you also mute King Kong, though?
I have not. I feel like Kong isn't as talked about.
I don't trust Twitter enough, because
if you don't have that, it might sneak through. That's all I'm saying.
No, I'm saying I don't trust Twitter enough because they might take out Donkey Kong.
Yeah.
They might take out, like, oh, King George or something. Like, it's like, nah. Mm-mm. Is it the combination of the words, the one words? Even if I do hashtag King Kong, if King space Kong, that's going to get through. So it's like, nah, I'm not bothering.
And man, you really can't tell nowadays. Twitter blue. After, like, 10 fakeouts of, like, tomorrow... Tomorrow it's going away. Next week, tomorrow it's going away. Finally, all pre-existing verified accounts are now no longer verified. You have to pay for Twitter Blue.
Not all.
So that's the next bit. Is basically anyone that wasn't just a that wasn't. Sucking the taint of Elon already was just like, I'm not paying for that.
They said in abject confusion and shock, I'm not paying for that.
So now Elon is buying Twitter Blue for certain celebrities.
So here's the funny thing about that. The whole problem with Elon was that it was a lords and ladies system of, oh, the upper echelon get the check mark. Everyone should get it. It should be there forever. No one should get special privilege. And now the people that pay get the blue check mark, but there's a handful of celebrities getting special privileges and just being gifted a check mark.
But that's for the future. It's less like, look, they're having fun with their blue check mark. Don't you want one as well?
No, it is clearly about, oh, they were a dissenter. Because it was people like Stephen King who just said, Elon, this is stupid. I will never buy this from you. Twitter Blue is the LeBron. Dumbest thing I've ever said. LeBron's just cheap. He's not buying nothing. I'm talking about
people like LeBron is just cheap.
Oh no, this is a legitimate thing. LeBron was going through a celebration. I think they had won a championship or something. So he's playing music in the background, and Spotify ass comes up because he doesn't pay for Spotify Premium. LeBron is just cheap. So that's why he's not paying for Twitter Blue. But Stephen King is just like, no. This is a terrible system. But then suddenly, if he has it, people are like, oh, even someone like Stephen King, who was all poo-pooing it, is into it. it might be worth buying it. Elon really thinks he's, and it's also because he thinks it's funny. He thinks it's funny to go, oh, you don't want it? Here it is anyway.
That is pretty funny.
Have you seen just like, you know, like certain celebrities will like, you know, post something and then you go into the replies. Have you seen some of the things that people are saying about buying Twitter Blue?
Oh, dude, so many. I pay for free speech.
I paid
yes,
for free
I'm paying
speech.
For freedom.
Oh, that was.
I'm paying for 1776.
It was legitimately trending. Paid for free speech was trending. You know you'd have. Don't be the main character of Twitter any day.
Keep your head down. Also, there was that dude that was just like, I love ketchup and McGriddles.
And it was legitimately McGriddles was trending. I was like, why is McGriddles trending? And it was all just ketchup and McGriddles. He said something like, I can't believe y'all eating McGriddles bone dry without any ketchup. It's just like, what are we?
People just laser focused on this one dude. Just like, wait, what?
And, dude, you never want to be that. So, yeah, Elon is falling apart. There was a report that about 19,000 people had paid for Twitter Blue after Elon took over and said you can get verification through it or the checkmark through it. And since April 20th, the day that everybody else lost theirs, 420, haha, all the legacies went away, a resounding 28 more people bought Twitter Blue.
Not bad.
Let's see. 19,028. Oh, well, hold on. I typed that wrong. 28. Let's see. Where's it? Times 8 is 150,000. How much did he pay for Twitter again?
44 billion.
44 billion.
All right. So...
He's chipping it away.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6,
somebody
7,
did
8,
this
9.
Math. Yeah, he would need 69,000 years to make it worth it.
I mean, with
somebody broke that math down.
43,999,850,000 bucks to go.
Yeah, he's so close.
Wow.
I think what was said for
any more furniture to sell? Sorry, continue.
Oh, dude. If I had the money, I would have bought the Twitter logo.
You know what?
I would have bought that giant bird.
You know, maybe he can sell the Super Heavy. Oh wait.
I think there was a report that said something like, in order for Twitter Blue to be sustainable to where they don't need advertisers and it could pay for everything, they needed something like 24 million subscribers monthly.
Monthly.
He has 19,000.
Oh, is Twitter Blue a monthly subscription?
Yeah, mm-hmm. What do you think it was?
I thought it was just one.
No.
Oh, no.
It's $8 no. every month.
Oh, really?
Yeah, no, it's
yes.
a monthly.
Horrible.
Yes. Yes, it is.
You're that more interested now, right?
Oh my goodness.
20 to 29. DA is going to be number 29. Here it comes.
You thought it was a one-time $8 flip?
Because there's some, you know, you got some apps where you just go, hey, here's a music app.
Pay for
like
it once.
$3. And I pay that little $3.
Yeah, I had a Black Music Player or Black Player or something like that. It was like $3. Yeah, I was like, whatever.
Like, whatever. It's fine. So I was just thinking, like, you know, maybe people, is it really.
That
just,
bad.
Just do it. It's $8.
It's $8 for a lifetime of Twitter.
That's horrible. Well, you know, how long that lifetime
would
be.
It's still the lifetime of Twitter. It's just not your lifetime. But
No. I'm saying the lifetime of Twitter could be next year.
No, that's what I'm saying. It's still a lifetime. Just the lifetime of Twitter.
It's technically a lifetime.
It's technically the lifetime of Twitter. But yeah, no, it's not $8. I feel like to do that, he would probably make it like $300 to $500. And then gold companies, they have to pay $1,000 a month for a gold check mark. And if you're an employee of that, you can get the sub, you know, I'm affiliated with that company, for $50 per person a month.
Oh,
yeah. Oh,
man.
Oh, a VTuber got scammed. So they went, I will try to get the gold verification, which is the company verification. Went through the process, paid their $1,000, everything. They went, no, you don't get that. And we keep your money. Because it is in the terms of services that if you are not accepted into the program, there is no refund for your $1,000.
Wow. Wow.
So I was like, what the f-?
So pay $1,000 to maybe get
to
a thing.
To maybe be accepted into the verification of gold.
For the privilege of paying me $1,000 next month.
Yes, for the rest of the months.
Yeah, Dad, I'm going to comment on that in a second. Meme, I didn't see this before. Lanky, I am referring to Lanky Kong from Donkey Kong 64, one of the five playable characters in the game. Go look him up. He looks ridiculous. Yeah, Dad, I've actually seen that sentiment a lot, where because of the algorithm changes, where that's basically, if you have Twitter Blue, you're going to be, the algorithm is going to favor you more.
Yes.
I just saw Lanky question mark. That's just, I just assumed you didn't know who he was.
But I, you know, I am perfectly fine with people, that, you know, content creators, I'm going to pay the $8 to stay on top of the algorithm. Mm-hmm. You, if that's for your business, if that's your type of thing, you think that's going to boost you for that $8, you're gonna get a $200 return. It is well worth it. Even if you're putting money in Elon's pocket, it is well worth it for your own personal gain. I am perfectly fine with that type of thing. It's the people that are just like, oh, it's for the free speech. I want to support. Those are the ones where I'm like,
I think Jet. This is the first time. You have done something from what I have said. Thank you.
Oh, if that was just...
Oh, it's coming. Don't worry.
The good... The one guy... Like, the lip...
In the background.
The fucking...
Like, mother...
Make it Mike, please. That's... I need that.
Oh boy.
I need that in my fucking life.
Hold on, I'm going to get that on stream here in just a second. But the last thing that I wanted to talk about, which is why I mentioned the Super Heavy, was that was like the other big thing, was SpaceX had their launch of their new rocket that's supposed to be launched. Like twice to three times. We can say it did that at least. Which is like 2 to 3 times stronger than any of NASA's Apollo rockets. It got off the ground, it launched successful, and then started careening out of control to the point that the, you know, ground control was like, all right, self-destruct, and they blew up the rocket in air before it careened off course and did serious damage to some popular, like, population center. reports and story coming out after that, SpaceX and Elon and what have you kind of skimped out on the launch pad itself, where, you know, if you look at any of the NASA launches, there's the vent chamber, the flame diverter that is underneath the rocket that basically all the exhaust from the engines gets diverted to the sides. There's also like a pool of water and stuff that also diffuses it slightly to make sure that the force doesn't go directly into the ground and damage anything. They just decided to launch on a slab of concrete.
Cool.
Completely decimated the ground underneath it. Gigantic pieces of concrete basically blown up as shrapnel. I don't know if this is true, but apparently there was like pieces of concrete that landed in the parking lot near the launch bay that ruined a truck.
Oh, yeah, sounds right. That truck got obliterated.
Like, just... utter stupidity. Okay, what happens when you put the most force, a bomb, basically directly into a flat surface? What do you think's gonna happen?
I don't know if Elon would know what would happen.
No, he wouldn't.
Oh, okay. So, the monkey enemy that seems to be facing Godzilla and Kong is a giant orangutan, which is what Lanky Kong is. That's why people are saying they're going to face Lanky. But yeah, go, If Ralph, if you want to say something while I pull up this picture.
We were talking about Netflix series or just series in general earlier, or series relocating. What was funny to me actually is just today I finished a bi-yearly rewatch of Code Geass, and it's because it was on Netflix. And I was like, okay, cool. I'm just going to start watching it. I finished it today, and it said at the very tail credits, it says leaving Netflix on 4/24/23.
What?
Finished it literally just in time.
You barely finished it. That's whack. Yep. I wanted you to come back 2 days later. All right, yeah, I thought. Whoops.
I would have been the most angry.
2 episodes from the finale.
There it is. Beautiful.
The f***ing lip is killing me. Just
oh, dude,
so
that's the best detail.
It's
honestly, that is like literally. It was at Yomicon. It was at Yomicon. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All of you guys were there. Oh man, this is beautiful. This is beautiful, Det.
Hey, welcome to our world.
Yep. Oh man, but that is all that I had. Like I said, pretty late news week. And what have you?
At least we got a nice rant out of it.
Oh yeah,
me playing Red Dead. No, that was long before the stream. That was like pre-pandemic, way pre-pandemic. All right.
Is there any movie you guys are interested in coming out soon? Because I was talking to Peanut, and I was like, "Hey, are we gonna do a movie soon? Because you know, some stuff might be coming out." He's like, "I don't know what's coming out," and I started thinking like, I have no idea what's coming out, and I don't think I care about anything except Spider-Man.
Yeah, Into the Spider-Verse. Or Across the Spider-Verse. Let me see. Movies.
I know Guardians come out, but like it's Guardians, and that's whatever to me. Guardians is next week.
Let's see. Yeah, Jan,
next Friday.
April.
Street Fighter VI news. There wasn't a lot of news you could...
a lot of the world stuff that they showed off.
Yeah.
Looks a lot of fun.
They learned a lot from their follies of Street Fighter V in terms of single player content with that bush story mode. They are really trying to get back into the like Street Fighter EX alpha days of mini games and that type of thing. And I think this is going to be potentially the most complete Street Fighter that we've had in probably 20 years.
I don't know.
MK fans keep weeping.
And the thing is, Across the Spider-Verse is in June.
Yep.
Hopefully.
I don't see like, that I think the only thing that I was like excited to see was Mario. Besides that, like Guardians 3, I'll probably end up going to see. But I haven't honestly seen a couple of the last superhero movies in theaters. Just haven't had
Why would you?
Want to go.
When Shazam comes to streaming 3 weeks after its release.
You heard what has grossed more than that movie, right?
No, I didn't.
Morbius made more sweep? Money than Shazam.
Morbius sweep?
Another one that, like, I want to see, and this, and I will fully admit this is purely nostalgia. Rise of the Beasts for Transformers Rise of the Beasts, just because I was a big Beast Wars mark back in the day.
No, I feel like that could be a cool spectacle.
I just want to see Cheetor on screen, and that's about it.
But beyond that, you know, I'm a movie dude, and it's like, I got nothing going on.
Did you see Evil Dead?
No, I haven't seen it yet, but I will be seeing it sometime this week.
Okay. I'm just thinking, like, what horror movies are coming out? And that's, like, the only one that I feel like I've seen.
There was a... Who was it? Russell Crowe or...
I know what you're talking about.
The Pope's Exorcist.
Yes.
It looked terrible. I will... No, I still... Meme, I still have movies to watch. I still have the last two of those 9 or 12 suggested movies that I had. I still have those. I still have stuff to watch. I just have nothing new that's coming out.
Didn't I recommend
that has me
a movie
excited.
For you to watch?
Lord of the Rings.
That's right.
Oh.
I will.
One of my favorite stories about getting somebody to watch Lord of the Rings is just one of the best. Now, some of you know of my childhood friend Kevin.
Oh yes.
There you go. the deep lore, as it were. Now, this man could not sit through a movie that was not about martial arts mayhem. Like, if this is not a Steven Seagal or Jean-Claude Van Damme brutal action beatdown murder fest, he's not interested. He will not care. We took this man to a Harry Potter movie when those were still releasing. Man fell asleep midway through and snored in the theater for
good,
the latter
good
half.
Good man.
Of Order of the Phoenix.
Slumped.
Oh, so. So all of us, we were hanging out. We were talking. Okay, we want to watch Lord of the Rings. Some of us were talking about it. I was rereading the books. I think I was rereading The Hobbit during high school. And Kevin's like, oh, I've heard some things about, because this is when those movies were like just finished releasing, just hyped up, like VHS days. So we're like, fuck it, let's put in, you know, Fellowship of the Ring. We're watching it. This man blacks out, passes right the fuck out.
Good man.
Dead asleep. We decide to keep watching. We're having fun. We're playing board games and watching that movie in the background. Kevin's passed out. Two Towers is on. We get to the scene of the battle for Helm's Deep. Oh my God. It's the part where the rain starts falling on the Orichai army. Kevin wakes up and he's like, what the fuck is going on? And let me explain to you, the entire rest of that film was Kevin going off like a literal fanboy, just hollering, chanting, let's go, let's fucking, yeah, get fucking body.
What a hype beast. What a monstrous hype beast.
He was nerd raging the entire fight scene. He built entire gaming profiles and entire like call outs in professional gaming based off of Legolas. The man took a 0% I'm napping interest and melded into his everyday life off of one scene.
After missing one and two thirds of a movie.
Yep.
Unbelievable. What a monster.
Oh my God.
All right. Mr. Fact Man, what you got for us?
20 facts about the law.
I fought the law and I won.
Deuce.
And because of that, I will pick one. 1, 2, 12. 1, 3. 2, 1, 2, 3, 12, 18, 19. 1, 2, 3, 5, 12, 18, 19, 20.
You only get one, Alfonso.
Two.
Two. Deuce, Mike.
Not Yo. Really funny, but very interesting.
All right.
The reason one is asked to raise her right hand in court was because in England, back in the day, one was branded after a crime on the palm of their right hand. M for murderer, T for thief, things of that nature. So when a modern judge asks them to raise their right hand, they're looking for a brand.
That's interesting.
Huh. Yeah, I remember reading about that before.
And that makes a lot of sense, where you put your hand up and it's just like, all right, you got the M.
What are we doing here?
Well, then again, that's also kind of like, hey, now, come on. I understand I got the T, but I don't mean I did this. I've repented for my crime.
That just seems like, okay, yeah.
You're forever
it's going
this
in with
person.
Prejudice. Yeah. Okay. He's got the T, so now we got to think of this dude as a thief.
It'd be like if a murder did happen and they were the suspect. It's just like, well, you already got it. Yeah. You're not even given a chance of due process. Hang him.
Raise your right hand. Sir, take off your glove.
I don't want to.
Take off your glove.
No. Not all the facts are going to be funny. Sometimes they're just interesting. Yeah. Like with the foot and the arm and the wrist thing. Just interesting stuff.
That's just something I've never known.
That was crazy.
And I think it's good to know things like that.
Yep. Yes. Every now and then.
You just reminded me, and I did it again. I'm still amazed.
I have my foot up on my arm right now.
Yeah, it's one of the... Oh, it's, yeah, some people weren't fans back when we did that. The length between your foot and I think like your forearm, your elbow, something like that.
Between your wrist and your elbow.
The area between your wrist and your elbow is the same length of your foot. So if you put your foot up to it, it's the same length. Just a crazy...
I just love the fact that when that happened, it was just like all of us simultaneously were like,
never really thought about it. And then we started doing it because DA found the fact. He looked at his arm and then his foot and then he tried it. He was like, oh, what the f-? And then he said the fact. So I'm just watching this man do something crazy. And I'm like, I have no idea what's going on.
Beautiful stuff. All right. With that, we will be ending this episode of the podcast, The Stuff. There potentially might not be one next week just because I will be out of town. And just again, when I am out of town, it's hard for me to get back in.
Before the allotted time. Now.
Correct. My dad is visiting from out of state, so obviously I will be visiting quite a bit. So we shall see. Tomorrow, going to be starting Resident Evil 2. We did finish Hollow Knight.
Oh, I was just watching the tournament, and at the end, it was just like, we're finishing Hollow Knight, and somebody called you out. I don't need that sass.
I was like, one of the guys that I play with all the time, Dave, he's like, I've been seeing a lot of notifications. I'm like, you shut up. yeah, we finally finished it, so we'll be moving on to Resident Evil 2 until, obviously, May, and then everything gets dropped.
You can honestly, depending on how long your sessions are, you can finish it Resident Evil 2. At least one of the campaigns.
We'll see. We shall see.
You are going to have a fit with Mr. X, though.
It's gonna be great. I mean, at least Resident Evil 7 somewhat trained me.
Mm-hmm.
With, you know, the Bakers. But yeah.
God, I love the Bakers.
What was I thinking? Wednesday, so Monday that, Tuesday trials, Wednesday is coin box, nothing Thursday, probably won't be doing anything Friday too, because I'll be driving to go visit.
I should be free this week to do start.
Yeah, are we sure?
Yeah, okay.
Should. Should. Like this week
is asterisk.
This week was not possible at all for me. I had a music festival I went to downtown here on Friday, and Saturday I had D&D research for locations to do. So I was very busy. But this upcoming weekend, Saturday is a fat no. Sunday I'll be around, but Friday I got no plans.
There you go.
Thursday? No plans.
There you go. Over on A List Exists, we are doing another episode of Revisited. We're putting out the next episode of Bad Movie Day, which is, what did we just watch? Skyscraper.
There you go.
Because these are so much easier to do. Eventually, I am going to put up the back catalog of, we did Jason X, League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, and Mortal Kombat Annihilation. Those are going to go up. It's just a lot harder to work
League
with right
of Extraordinary
now.
Gentlemen.
Yeah, it was a
just
not...
remembering Mr. Hyde, everything that he did.
Hey, you should have watched Pooh, Blood, and Honey.
Because
that was a movie.
There we go. All right. With that, thank you, everybody, for tuning into this episode of the Podcast of Stuff. We will see you, potentially, next week.
In some shape or form. Later.
Oh, yeah. Next Bad Movie Day is Sunday. We're watching.
All right.
What are we watching?
What are we watching? Fan4Stick.
Fan4Stick. Ooh.
Fan4Stick.
Fantastic Four. But the Fox one, the new one.
Oh, no.
The one we watched at
the Donk?
Yes.
Yes. Have fun with that, everybody.
Fan4Stick. Oh, no.
We will watch that Sunday, depending on if Mike can make it or not. We can do it later in the day if needed. Otherwise, it'll be about 4 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Eastern.
All right.
Okay, okay. I'll be there for that for sure.
Have a good rest of your night, everybody. Bye-bye.
Later.